Today I'm gathering a trio of horror films that have recently been released to the masses, all of which take place by the water. We've all heard this synopsis before. A group of youngsters gather together for a weekend to drink, do drugs, have sex, and party. They're out to have a good time until blank happens. If I had a nickel every time I wrote that synopsis for a review, I'd have like a whole bunch of nickels. Welcome back to ML Miller Frights, a part of the Kings of Horror Network. I'm ML Miller. Before we dive in, remember to like, share, and subscribe to this channel. In the early days, it's crucial to get the word out about the new channel to new folks across the internet and tame and tease that all-important YouTube algorithm. I'll indicate in the review and down below where you can find these films, along with their trailers. Let's get into it. I guess the reason I'm noticing this getaway weekend horror theme is because travel is so limited right now. The cabin in the woods is a common horror trope, placing city kids out of their element in the woods and then putting them through the ringer with some kind of horrific terror. That's the stuff of quite a few horror films that I've seen in my day, and probably you have as well. It's just more evident now that vacation seems like something so unattainable in this time of self-seclusion and economic strife. I'm sure this is just the beginning of the trend of movies made with a small cast set in a remote location as people try to make films during the pandemic. Horror will most likely thrive more than most genres, as it doesn't need extravagant sets, a large cast, or crowded common areas to be made. Just trap a few kids in the dark and give it some kind of horrific distinction, and you've got yourself a horror movie. Take these three films, for example. First off, there's The Beach House, released a week or so ago on Shudder. This one features a couple, Emily, played by Liana Liberato, and Randall, played by Noah LeGros, who go to a sleepy beach town in the off-season to find another couple in Randall's father's house. This couple are friends of Randall's father, Mitch, played by Day of the Dead's Jake Weber, and Jane, played by Marianne Nagel. After some awkward moments, as neither couple really know each other, and they are separated by quite a few years, they soon break bread together, and Randall even shares his pot-infused chocolates with them. This leads to a night of partying as the two couples from two generations party and bond. It's at this point that you don't exactly know when or how the horror will drop, but The Beach House plays things very close to the vest for a long time while we get to know this cast. You can't stop the tides, though, and though Emily has aspirations of studying underwater organisms, no one really understands the horrors that have crept up from the ocean, first as a mist, then as some kind of biochemical agent, which pollutes, contorts, and controls the entire beach town, changing the few occupants there into some kind of infectious creatures. Oblivious to the threat as it drifts in like fog from the ocean, the quartet struggle to survive long enough to get to some kind of shelter, but fear they are already infected by this unknown menace. The Beach House is Lovecraftian horror at its best. While Emily spouts some kind of gobbledygook about marine biology and undiscovered alien environments underwater, there really is no explanation as to what the hell is going on. It's just some kind of creeping terror in the fog. But like Color Out of Space and Stephen King's The Mist, whatever it is that is released, it's changing the environment and the people in it on a horrifying level. This leads to some grueling scenes of body horror and places our cast into an alien landscape where the familiar is completely changed. There really are no rules as to what's going on, which gives this film an ungrounded and uncomfortable feel. But if you're a fan of the undescribable terrors that often pop up in Lovecraft lore, you're going to dig this one. The metaphorical threat is twofold, as it seems like the last vacation for both couples to take together. Emily and Randall just seem to be going in different paths, with her having aspirations of higher education, and Randall quitting school and leading a more aimless lifestyle consisting of drugs and living in his father's beach home full-time. Mitch and Jane are at another impasse, as Jane is very sick with what seems to be cancer, and her health is fading fast. When the monster fog rolls in, it represents a literal wedge between the couples, as well as a wedge between the individuals, as the younger couple seems to fight the changes, while the older couple embrace it. One issue I had with The Beach House was that the acting and the script felt a bit forced. The actors are fine, but I think the lines they are forced to speak needed another pass to feel a little more natural. Liana Liberato is a trooper, though, as she really is put through the ringer in her role as Emily. The vague ending is going to be a deal-breaker for some for The Beach House. It offers no real answers and instead provides a rather nihilistic comment on both relationships between lovers and the relationships between generations. I do admire the amazing practical effects, though, from the goop in the trees to the thing in the cellar. It's creepy as all get out. Next up is Lake of Death, also known as De Dødes Dørn, a Norwegian film that bobbed up on Shudder last week. Again, a group of youngsters return to a family cabin in the woods off of a lake in the magical land of Norwegia. This one is more of a traditional style horror, reminiscent of Evil Dead, Friday the 13th, and the obscure 80s gem, The Slayer. And if you remember that old nugget, congrats, you're as old and into horror as I am. This is the first time Lillian, played by Iben Ackerley, is returning to the cabin since her twin brother Bjorn, played by Patrick Walsh McBride, disappeared into the lake 2 years ago. And her friends are there to support her on this trip that is supposed to be somewhat cathartic for her. While the usual tomfoolery of drugs, drinks, and debauchery occur, Lillian struggles with her own mental state as she keeps hallucinating that a black liquid substance is creeping all over her body, down the walls, in the sinks, and all over the place. When her friends begin disappearing, Lillian believes the lake, rumored to be bottomless, and the site of much more horror in the local folklore, is out to get them. While not as metaphorically resonant as The Beach House, Lake of Death makes up for it with its love of 80s horror. When a cellar is found in the cabin, they say, "This is just like the cellar from The Evil Dead." When someone is sleepwalking, one of the kids quotes Freddy Krueger. While this might be clunky in an American film, it really does feel like genuine adoration for some of the best eras of horror. Still, there's a lot that makes it stand on its own as an effective horror film, despite its familiarity to a lot of films that we've seen. What makes Lake of Death distinctive is that it really walks a tightrope, holding back exactly what kind of horror this film is. Lillian experiences all kinds of hallucinations, but are these simply visions of a damaged mind, or some kind of premonition of supernatural happenings to come? Lake of Death flirts with being a film of supernatural terror from ancient Norwegian folklore. Or maybe it's a slasher film with a human horror stalking the group. The film keeps the answer quiet for an extremely long time, suggesting one or the other, or both, or none at all. While I was itching for the answer, I was having fun getting to know these campers and wondering when and how each will meet their impending demise. One criticism of Lake of Death is that nothing completely horrific happens until about the hour mark. Sure, there are all kinds of suspicious activity occurring and strange visions we see through Lillian's eyes, but the group isn't really affected until quite a long way in. This makes for a lot of scenes of people scratching their heads at the minor oddities going on, like someone abducting and tying up the dog, someone making breakfast for the group, someone opening and closing doors, along with a few too many scenes of Lillian doubting her own sanity when she sees black liquid dripping from everywhere. I was never really looking at my watch during Lake of Death, but the visions and prolonged mystery may be tiresome to some. I also found that the actress playing Lillian, Iben Ackerley, was overselling the dour and melancholy act a bit much. Sure, I understand she has just lost her twin brother and is dealing with a lot of stress, but if she is this fragile and unstable, she should be getting therapy and not going away on a trip with her friends for the weekend. While it seems they might be there to help her through this tough time, most of the film is dedicated to them partying, going off having sex, and taking notes for a paranormal podcast, while two of them are making sexual advances towards her. There's not a lot of support going on for Lillian here, which makes the point of all of them meeting at her dead brother's house a little pointless. Ackerley is still a great actress. She looks a little bit like a cross between Jennifer Lawrence and Gretchen Mol. It helps that she's walking around in a little nightie for most of the movie. I did have a lot of fun watching these guys party, though, which is summed up in a few quirky and lively scenes involving a bedsheet ghost and some balls-out faux American rock and roll. Lake of Death wraps in a twisted but tidy manner, reminiscent of slasher and Cabin in the Woods films from yesteryear. There's a pretty solid reveal, and the whole film has some wonderfully startling imagery and scenes of tension and suspense. Fans of those old slasher and monster films will find a lot of familiar territory covered in Lake of Death. Still, it's a good watch. Finally, there's The Rental, which is set to be released this week from IFC Midnight to on-demand, digital download, and drive-ins. Once again, a quartet of young pretty people, consisting of the guests Dan Stevens as Charlie, Community's Allison Brie as his girlfriend Michelle, Shameless's Jeremy Allen White as Charlie's brother Josh, and A Girl Walks Home Alone at Night's Sheila Vand as Josh's girlfriend Mina. This group rents a house by the beach from Taylor, played by the always awesome character actor Toby Huss. Taylor immediately rubs the group of youngsters the wrong way for renting to Charlie, the white guy, played by Stevens, an hour after denying Mina, the Persian woman, played by Van, the house for the weekend. Something Mina isn't afraid to confront Taylor about. This awkward altercation makes for an uneasy beginning to the trip, which is celebrating the success of Charlie and Mina's business. Complications arise when the lines between the two couples blur during the first night of partying, and some lewd activity is caught on video that they discovered wired into the showerhead. What transpires is not only the destruction of these two couples' relationships, but their lives, as it seems someone is stalking them from the shadows with deadly intent. While this one doesn't deal with the folklore or biological explanations to the horror, The Rental is no less terrifying thanks to some complex relational issues from writers Dave Franco, brother of James, and Mighty Joe Swanberg. Even before the creepy guy in the old man mask in the shadows appears, the horror of self-destructive relationships is put front and center. Paranoia and tension reach a fever pitch by the midway point when they all find out there's a video recording of their shenanigans somewhere as they tear the house apart trying to find it. Franco and Swanberg, with co-writer Mike Dembski, really know how to develop fascinating characters who may not be easy to like, but are mesmerizing to watch trip over themselves due to their own faults. Dave Franco directs this tight little slasher stalker film and manages to prolong the inevitable confrontation between the quartet and the man in the shadows to agonizing lengths. Once shit does start heading fanward, Franco isn't afraid of being blunt and brutal with the violence. There are quite a few scenes that play off fantastically, especially if you haven't been spoiled by the trailer, so don't watch that if you haven't seen it. Franco pulls a Hitchcock here as he shows the terror approaching an unsuspecting victim, which only makes the violent punctuation of the scene more resonant. This is another slow starter in terms of when the horror begins, but the acting is top-notch and the complexity of the relationships were able to hold me over until the blood started flowing. I'm sure some might disagree with the pace, but I was really impressed by the patient hand Franco was in doling out the terrors. The ending might leave some cold, but I found it to be all the more chilling in the callous and hopeless way everything wraps up. All three of these films provide some lush and gorgeous shots of the environment before all hell breaks loose. There's plenty of beautiful scenery to chew on between all of those bloodletting and horrifying moments. So if you can't get to that vacation dream destination this year, there are at least these three stellar terrors by the water to enjoy. If the horror is at this quality, I really don't mind seeing three horror films with the same setting, as all of them distinguish themselves with tone, theme, and specific terror. If I were to rate these films, I think I felt Lake of Death was fun for nostalgia's sake, edging out The Rental by a skosh for second place, with the top spot reserved for the otherworldly weirdness of The Beach House. Still, all three are worthy of a few jumps and scares. That'll be it for today. If you like this video, please pound that thumbs up button. Share this video with your pals across social media. If you're looking for written reviews, you can find them on mlmillerwrites.com. And be sure to subscribe and ring the bell for alerts for future videos. Thanks so much for your time, and take care. Stuck inside your